First of all, I would like to thank all the panelists before me for their insights, for their testimony, and also for their inspiration. I welcome the opportunity to talk with my colleagues about nurturing cultures of just peace. For in the last decade, during the so-called war on terrorism, our country has been embroiled in the discussion of just war. During the invasion of Iraq and the prolonged war in Afghanistan, just war theories from Augustine all the way to Aquinas have been rehashed again and again to argue for or against America's military actions. Yesterday, as Latifa reminded us, President Obama signed the Strategic Partnership Agreement in Afghanistan, allowing the U.S. to withdraw combat troops and to wind down the very unpopular war. So this is a very good time to think about what just peace entails. In case you have not looked at the title closely, let me remind you, just peace in the title of this panel is not one word, but it's linked with a hyphen. The in-between space and the interconnections between just and peace is the subject for our discussion this afternoon. Several speakers before me asked, can we have peace that is not just? Can we demand justice and justice alone without peace? And who is to decide what is justice and justice for whom? Is peace an utopian state without war, conflicts, or even tears? We are reminded this afternoon of the letter from the Birmingham jail written by the Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. when he said that he was gravely disappointed with the white moderate who is more devoted to order than to justice, who prefers a negative peace, which is the absence of tension, to a positive peace, which is the presence of justice. Dietrich Bonhoeffer wrote that there is no cheap grace in his resistance to the Nazi regime. Today, Christians must proclaim that there is no cheap peace. In the Gospel, Jesus confronted the power of the Roman Empire and the religious elites of his time. He proclaimed the coming of the kingdom of God as a counter-narrative to the imperial power of the Roman Empire. Instead of glorifying military might and fanfare of war, Jesus said, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God." He was tortured and died as a political prisoner on the cross, an instrument to instill suffering and fear for anyone who dared to challenge imperial occupation. Yet throughout the age, the message of Jesus has been domesticated and co-opted to serve the status quo. Time and time again, Christian doctrines and beliefs have been used to justify the Crusades, the conquest of the Americas, and the colonization of the world's majority. The Christian right and those advocating the gospel of prosperity have used the gospel to bolster the 1% to the detriment of the 99%. Especially women and children, the working class, racial and ethnic minorities, and lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgendered people. Middle-class churches keep proclaiming peace when there is really no peace. Just peace, I suggest, requires nothing less than collective metanoia, repentance, of our own complicity in supporting the violence of the unjust system. Our own American economic system condemns one out of four young children to live in poverty is both violent and unjust. Without recognizing the terror and violence inflicted in the name of national security, bailing out big banks and protecting corporate interests, we as Christians will never fully understand the cost of just peace or the cost of discipleship. The pursuit of just peace requires us to begin speaking about divine power in radically new ways. Christian images of God are so often shaped by dominant images of power and might. In the past, God was envisioned as a heavenly patriarch or monarch. Divine power understood as hierarchical, patriarchal, and one-sided has often been used to reinforce the powers and principalities on earth. Just peace requires to see divine power in relations, in the interstices, in the space between us. We need to see beyond the false dichotomies of black and white, and to begin to embrace the pregnant potentialities in the gray areas. Here at the Episcopal Divinity School, we encourage our students to say both and, instead of either or. The question in interfaith dialogue and engagement is not to draw a firm line between Christians and non-Christians. The issue at hand is not whether people profess belief in God or not. The question is what kind of ultimate reality and what kind of power that people affirm. Those who affirm power as a top-down process, and those who see God or ultimate reality as upholding those who are in power, they are closer to each other, no matter whether they are Christians or not. From understanding dialogue as service to mission, to the heathens or Gentiles, in the first half of the 20th century, to the discussion of multiple religious belongings, the Christian Church has changed very drastically in its attitude toward peoples of other faiths. As we face the future, interfaith dialogue must address the burning issues of our planet and humankind, such as the rise of fundamentalisms of all kinds, the assertion of religious identity and fragmentation of community, as well as the exploitation of religious passion for violence. Interfaith dialogue must be a force for peace building, because in contemporary politics, there are the dual forces of politicization of religion and the theologization of politics. In the past several years, a group of theologians have begun to explore the concept of polydoxy, not orthodoxy, not monodoxy, it's polydoxy, in order to describe the multiplicity and relationality of God and of our world. Poli suggests that there are internal diversities within the Christian tradition and also in the polarity of the world's religious and spiritual traditions. Polydoxy foregrounds the diversity of cultural and religious traditions of the world and sees such diversity as a blessing and not a curse. Theologian John Tatanamo even says that religious diversity is a natural outcome of expression of human encounter with divine multiplicity. A theology of multiplicity seeks company and does not reduce the other into the same. This afternoon, we are in close proximity and in good company with each other. I was deeply touched when Gerard reminded us, without knowing other people's traditions, we first impoverished ourselves. I was very moved by Jihan when she reminded us, during meditation, we became mindful and open to what we have excluded. She also talks beautifully about intra and inter-religious dialogue. I am grateful to Swamiji, a poet and a prophet among us. He talks about faith and dialogue in such a profound way that I will always lift up this image of paying attention to the rippling water of the lake that is in our mind. Without knowing those rippling waters, we cannot achieve inner peace and cannot work together for the outer peace. Latifa spoke so poignantly about peace being the fundamental principle of Islam. I was very moved when you said, even in distress and wartime, we have to seek ways to treat each other with humaneness. Last several months, I have been traveling in the United States because I am writing a book on the occupied movement. I want to share these two scenarios. I was in Oakland in March, in the basement of a downtown church. There, I met with a group of Methodist ministers, one minister from the Disciple of Christ, a rabbi, a pagan religious leader, and Muslims. Why this group was gathering there? It was because they were planning for a faith leaders' national gathering in Oakland. As I listened to the conversation, I was deeply inspired that Christians, Jews, Muslims, and pagans can all work together for the common good. But I want to conclude by sharing this story. I was at Patrick's alma mater, Union Theological Seminary, for a few days because I wanted to interview the so-called protest chaplains of Occupy Wall Street. These five students that I have interviewed, they have all participated to provide rituals, pastoral counseling and care for people who lived in Sakoti Park when the camp was still there. I asked them, what motivates you to go to help others? One young person, a woman, said, I have worked very often with people who look like me, a white person, who share my culture. But there in the park, I had the opportunity to work with people coming from many different traditions and help those homeless, those without food, those who in the middle of the night needed somebody to talk with. I thought Christian faith really means something to these young people. The future belonged to them. They are beacons of hope for me and for many others. Thank you.